What is ecology? The branch of biology that developed from natural history is called ecology. Ecology is the study of interactions that take place between the organisms and their environment. So that is what we are going to study in this module. That is all about ecology, the various concepts of ecology, the interdependence between the living organisms and the environment. Okay, that the whole study is called the ecology study. Okay, ecologists may ask, what a coyote eats, that is, it's animal like a wolf, how day length influences plants or migrating birds, or why tiny shrimp help breed ocean fishes or parasites. So like, ecologists are the ones who study this interdependence between the living organisms and the interdependence between the organisms and the environment. Okay, so we ecologists have the answers to such questions, that what a coyote eats, that what a wolf like animal it is, what it eats, how the day length influences plants or migrating birds, or why this tiny shrimp, that is the tiny prawns, help breed ocean fishes of parasites. That is, this tiny shrimp, that is the tiny prawns, feed on the parasites which are on the fishes. So how they are related with each other. So this basic things related to the environment, related to the interdependence. Okay, this study is called the ecology, and ecologists are the one who have studied this and who have answers to such questions. The biosphere, like we had seen in the previous module also, on Earth, living things are found in the air, on land, and in both fresh and salt water. The biosphere is the portion of the Earth that supports the living things. Okay, the biosphere is the portion of the Earth that supports the living things. Range of the biosphere is from high in the atmosphere to the bottom of the oceans, right? Because living things are everywhere, be it high in the sky or be it at the bottom of the ocean. So the range of biosphere is actually the whole area which is suitable for all the living organisms to, you know, survive. The biosphere supports diverse group of organisms in wide range of climates. Correct. So the climate, soils, plants and animals in one part of the world can be very different from those same factors in other part of the world. Correct. At every individual place, the climate, the soil, the atmosphere, the weather, everything is changed, and accordingly, the plants and animals surviving in that particular area of the world is different. Living things are affected by both physical or non-living environment and by other living things. Correct. The survival of the living things is affected by all the, you know, things that is going in and around. Maybe it is an non-living environment, the living environment, the physical, the climatical conditions. Okay, so living things are affected by all these factors. The factors that affect organisms are both abiotic and biotic, the living and the non-living. Okay, so the factors that affect the organisms are both abiotic and biotic. So what are the abiotic factors? So the examples of abiotic factors include air currents, temperature, moisture. Of course, these are non-living factors, abiotic factors, but they are responsible for affecting the survival of the organisms. Correct. So these are the abiotic factors. Ecology includes the study of features of the environment that are not living, because these features are a part of an organism's life. Abiotic factors have obvious effects on living things and often determine which species survives in a particular environment. Exactly. These abiotic factors are responsible, the temperature, the air current, the moisture, the weather conditions. Okay. So that is actually responsible to determine which species survive in which particular environment. And what are the biotic factors which affect the survival? The living things affect the other living things. Okay, biotic factors in the sense, the living things. All organisms depend on others directly or indirectly for food, shelter, reproduction or protection. Correct. All the living organisms depend on the other living organism directly or indirectly for food, shelter, reproduction, protection. Example, plants, animals, bacteria, anything that is living. Correct. So, levels of organization. To help ecologists understand the interactions of biotic and abiotic parts of the world, they have organized the living world into levels. Okay, so to have the interaction between the biotic and the abiotic parts of the world, the ecologists have organized the living world into levels. Okay, so the first is the organism, the second is the population, the third is the biological community, and the fourth is the ecosystem, and the fifth is the biosphere. Okay, so the living world, which is classified into these levels, so first is the organism, an individual living thing that is made of cells, uses energy, reproduces, responds, grow, develop. Okay, so that is called the organism. Correct. Organism, what you call as an organism, anything, any living thing that is made of cells, uses energy, reproduces, responds, grows, develops. Okay, so that is called the organism. Then what is population? A group of organisms, all of one species, which interbreed and live in the same place at the same time. So that is population. So these terms we use it, right? So technically speaking, organism is individual living thing that is made of cells, uses energy, reproduces, responds, grows, and develops. And population is a group of organisms, all of one species, okay, which interbreed and live in the same place at the same time. Okay, so that is a group of organisms. This population. Then biological community. All the populations of different species that live in the same place at the same time. All the populations of different species that live in the same place at the same time. Okay, of different species. Population was of the same species, correct? Of one species, correct? Biological community is all the population of different species that live in the same place at the same time. That is called the biological community. Okay, next is the ecosystem. Populations of plants and animals that interact with each other in a given area and with the abiotic components of that area, that is called the ecosystem. Okay, so ecology is a study, and study of what? It is a study of the ecosystem, that is population of the plants and the animals, like that means the organisms that interact with each other in a given area and with the abiotic components of that area as well. Okay. And biosphere, just now that we have seen, that is the stretch of the earth, the portion of the earth that supports or that is needed for the survival of the living beings, or which supports the life. Okay, that is called the biosphere. Then, interactions within the populations. So, organisms in the population share the resources of their environment, may determine how far apart the organisms live and how large the populations become. Then they compete with each other for food, water, mates, or other resources. Competition increases when resources are in short supply. This is the interaction within the population, okay, within the same species. Then, interaction within the communities. A change in one population in a community may cause changes in other population, right? Because they are interdependent. The change in one population in a community may cause changes in the other population. Changes can be minor, like an increase in the predators causes a decrease in the prey. Okay, so the predators are the one that depend on the prey for their food. Okay, so increase in the predators can cause a decrease in the prey, correct? Changes can be major, like a population may use up resources and in turn affecting another population. Okay, so this can also happen. The population may use up the resources and in turn affecting the another population. The biotic and the abiotic factors form the ecosystem. Biotic factors like the insects, grass, trees, all the living things. Okay, and the abiotic factors like the water, temperature, etc. make an ecosystem. Two major kinds of ecosystems are the terrestrial ecosystem, that is the forest, the meadows, etc. Meadows are the grass covered land, and the aquatic ecosystem, that can be salt water or the fresh water. Okay, so there are two types of ecosystem that where this biotic and abiotic factors are present and they are dependent on each other. But two types of ecosystem are present, that is the terrestrial ecosystem, okay, that is on land, and the aquatic ecosystem that is in water. Okay, then organisms in ecosystem, the place where an organism lives out its life is called a habitat. Okay, so that is the habitat where an organism lives, okay, its whole life, that is called the habitat. Ecosystem covers a large area of the earth. Habitat covers a small area of the ecosystem. Okay, so ecosystem is actually all the biotic and the abiotic factors together in an on the earth is called ecosystem. And habitat is actually an area where actually there are organisms living. Okay, so habitat size varies from organism to organism. Habitats are also shared with different species of the organism. And survival relationships. A predator is a type of consumer like a lion or an insect-eating bird. Correct. So that is called the predator. Okay. So predator is that which is like a lion or the insect-eating bird. Okay. These animals eat these animal predators eat are called the prey. Okay, so the animals that they eat are called the prey. So predator-prey relationships, such as the one between the cats and the mice, involve a fight for survival. But not organisms living in the same environment are in continuous battle for survival. Studies have shown that most species survive because of the relationships they have with the other species. The relationship in which there is close and permanent association between the organisms of different species. Like, it is not that when you talk about interdependence, so each one is dependent on other by harming the other. Okay, like when you talk about predator and prey. Okay, so it's not that there is a competition between the two different species, okay, by harming each other. It's not just the type of interdependence. There is also one relationship, one interdependence in which there is a close and permanent association between the organisms of different species, which they are both related to each other for their survival, and that is called the symbiosis. Symbiosis means living together. Okay, so three kind of symbiotic relationships are there. Okay, so symbiosis actually means living together. So first kind of symbiotic relationship is mutualism. So what is mutualism? Two species of organisms benefit from living in close association, like the ants and the acacia trees living in the subtropical regions of the world. The ants protect the acacia tree by attacking any animal that tries to feed on the tree, and the tree provides the nectar and a home for ants. So that is, they both help each other for their survival. Okay, two species of organism, different organism, benefit from living in close association. Okay, so that is one of the example. That is, they both are dependent on each other without harming each other. Okay, that is called the mutualism. Then there is commensalism. That is, one species benefits and the other species is neither okay, one species is benefited, which is dependent on it, but the other species, there is no difference in it. That is, there is no harm done, there is no benefit done. Okay, for example, the Spanish moss on the branches of the trees. The moss benefits because it uses the tree for the support. It holds on to the tree. The tree does not benefit, but it is not getting harmed either. Okay, so that is, one species is dependent, the other species does not get harmed, does not get benefited, nothing. Okay, so that is called the commensalism. In mutualism, even the other species was getting benefited, both the species were getting benefited without harming each other. In commensalism, only one species is getting benefited, the other species is not even getting harmed, not even getting benefited. Then there is parasitism. That is, one organism benefits while harming the another. Okay, one organism is getting benefited, but while harming the another. For example, the ticks or fleas on animals. The ticks or fleas on gets nutrients from the animal. Parasites have evolved in such a way that they harm, but usually do not kill the host species. Okay, they do not kill the species, but they do harm it. Okay, so that is called the parasites, and this word we hear it, right? The parasites. So parasites are such organisms which benefit from the other organism by harming it. Okay, If host dies, then parasite dies also, if they don't find another host. Okay, if the host dies, then parasite dies also if they don't find another host. Other examples of parasites are the certain bacteria, tapeworms, roundworms, mistletoe, all these are the different parasites that are depend on some other living organism by harming it. Okay, not by killing it, but by harming it. Nutrition and energy flow. Ecologists trace the flow of energy through communities to discover nutritional relationships between the organisms. Okay, so since every organism is dependent on each other, okay, on other living organism, so there is the energy flow as well through these communities. So the first, that is the producers, which are called the autotrophs. The ultimate source of the energy for life is the sun. Like the plants are the autotrophs that use the sun's energy to manufacture food, which is, of course, we know it's called the photosynthesis. So they are called the producers, which are called the autotrophs. Grass and trees are autotrophs. Some unicellular organisms such as the green algae also make their own nutrients. Okay, with the help of energy, they make their own nutrients. Okay, so the living organisms which with the help of energy make their own nutrients. Okay, those are called the autotrophs. Okay, so other organisms in the biosphere depend on the autotrophs for nutrients and energy. These dependent organisms are called the consumers. Okay, so autotrophs are actually the producers because they depend on the source of energy, that is sun, and make their own food or make their own nutrient. Okay, they are not dependent on any other living organism for the nutrients. Okay, so they are called the autotroph, that is the producers, and the other organisms which are dependent on the autotrophs for the nutrients, for the energy, those organisms are called the consumers. So, the consumers are called the heterotrophs. Okay, so these all things we had also gone through at the school level also, correct? So autotrophs are the producers, and the consumers which consume the autotrophs, they are called the heterotrophs. Okay, a bison eats grass, a deer nibbles the leaves of a clover plant, owl swallows a mouse. So all these, that is the bison, the deer and the owl, are the consumers incapable of producing their own food. Okay, they cannot produce their own food. They are dependent on the other living organism for their food. Whereas the plants, the algae, with the help of the sunlight, they are able to make their own food. So they are called the producers or the autotrophs. And these are called the consumers or the heterotrophs. Okay, they obtain, these heterotrophs obtain the nutrients by eating the other organisms. So heterotrophs include organisms that eat, that feed on only autotrophs, feed on only other heterotrophs, or feed on both autotrophs and the heterotrophs. Okay, so again, these heterotrophs which are dependent on the other living organism for their food, for their energy, for their nutrient, okay, they are again divided into the heterotrophs which feed on only autotrophs, the heterotrophs which feed on only other heterotrophs, and the heterotrophs which feed on both the autotrophs and the heterotrophs. Okay, so types of heterotrophs, that is, the first is the herbivore, that is a heterotroph that feeds only on the autotroph, that is the plants. Okay, those are called the herbivore or herbivorous animals that we talk. Okay, that is the rabbits, the grasshoppers, the squirrels, bees, etc. Okay, so those animals, those living organisms that feed on only plants, okay, they are called the herbivores. Then, the heterotrophs that eat other heterotrophs are, first is the carnivores, that is the animals that kill and eat the other animals. Okay, that is called the carnivores. And the scavengers that do not kill for food but eat the animals that have already died, that is the black vultures. Okay, so carnivores are the one that kill and eat the other animals, and the scavengers are the one that do not kill the animal or the organism for food but eat the animals that have already died. Okay, that is the vultures, that is the scavengers. Then there are omnivores, okay, that is the ones which consume both the autotrophs and the heterotrophs, that is example the raccoons, the opossums, the bears. Okay, So they are the one which consume both the autotrophs and the heterotrophs, that is the plants and the meat. Okay, then there are decomposers. So these are all the types of heterotrophs. Okay, herbivores, carnivores, scavengers, omnivores, and then the decomposers. That is the organisms that break down the dead and the decaying plants and animals into simpler molecules that can be more easily absorbed. Okay, that is examples of the protozoans, the bacteria, the fungi. Correct. These are the decomposers. That is, they decompose the organic matter present in the living, some living matter. Say the decaying plants or the animals. They decompose it. That is, break down it into the simpler molecules. Okay, so that are the decomposers. That decompose, degrade the organic matter present in the living thing. Okay, so that could be protozoans, bacteria, fungi. Okay, so that are called the decomposers. Then flow of matter and energy in the ecosystem. When you eat food such as an apple, you consume matter, correct? Matter in the form of carbon, nitrogen and other elements flow through the levels of an ecosystem from producers to consumers. Okay, like the producers generate their own food, their nutrients, and then it is the one on which the consumers depend. So there is flow of energy from the producers to the consumers. The apple also contains energy from the sunlight, correct? It's also obtained from a plant. Okay, so apple also contains energy from the sunlight that was trapped in the plant during the process of photosynthesis, correct? Then, as you cycle the matter of the apple, some trap energy is transferred from one level to the next. At each level, certain amount of energy is also transferred to the environment as heat. Okay, so as you cycle the matter of the apple that you are eating, some trap energy is transferred from one level to the next. At each level, a certain amount of energy is also transferred to the environment in the form of heat. So the question is, how do matter and the energy flow through the ecosystem? How the content, the matter and the energy flow through the ecosystem? That is how it flows. So it flows the food chain, that we know that how each organism is dependent on the other organism, on the food, and will directly then there is flow of energy as well. Okay, so food chain, that is the pathway for matter and energy. A food chain is a simple model that scientists use to show how matter and energy move through an ecosystem. Okay, in a food chain, nutrients and energy move from the autotrophs to the heterotrophs and eventually to the decomposers. Okay, after everything that is dead, the dead living matter. Okay, so all that for the bacteria, the fungi, the other microorganisms decompose it. Okay, so eventually to decomposers. A food chain is drawn using arrows to indicate the direction in which the energy is transferred from one organism to the next. Like for example, the berries. Okay, the mice are dependent on the berries, and the black bear then is dependent on the mice. And the arrows thus shows the flow of energy from these berries to the mice to the black bear. Most food chains consist of 2, 3, 4 transfers. Okay, so the most food chains consist of 2, 3, 4 transfer. It's not just the organism is receiving the energy on the food from only one transfer. It also consists, the food chain consists of 2, 3, 4 transfers. The amount of energy remaining in the final transfer is only a portion of what was available at the first transfer. The portion of the energy is given off as a heat at each transfer. Okay, some portion of the energy is given off as heat at each transfer. So the trophic levels in the food chain, they represent the links in the chain. Each organism in a food chain represents a feeding step or trophic level in the passage of the energy and the material. Okay, each organism represents a feeding step or the trophic level. So the first order heterotroph. Okay, so first order heterotroph is an organism that feeds on plants. Okay, the first heterotroph that is dependent on the autotroph. So first level heterotroph that feeds on plants such as the grasshopper. Then second order heterotroph is an organism that feeds on the first order heterotroph. Example, the bird that feeds on the grasshopper. A food chain represents only one possible route for the transfer of the matter and energy through an ecosystem. Many other routes may exist. Many different kinds of organisms eat a variety of food. So a single species may feed at several trophic levels, correct? Because it's not just that the organism, that is a bird, is only it feeds on the grasshopper. No, it might be a part of another food chain as well, correct? So this is only one, that is the organism that is feeding on the plant, grasshopper, and the bird that feeds on the grasshopper, that is only one possible source, possible route for transfer of matter and energy. But there can be n number of other routes as well, from where the food and the nutrient might be reaching, an organism might be reaching the bird. Okay, so that is why that is called the food web. Okay, so it is not a single source from where, a single level or a single source from where the organism is receiving the food and the nutrients and the energy. It might receive it from different sources, from different food chains. Okay, and then there comes this concept of the food web. So ecologists interested in the energy flow in an ecosystem may set up experiments with many organisms in the community as they can. So food web shows all the possible feeding relationships at each trophic level in a community. Food web represents a network of interconnected food chains formed by the herbivores and the carnivores. So actually it forms a web, because there are a lot of food chains in between the living organisms, and then all this network of interconnected food chains thus forms a food web. Okay, so this is how the food web actually looks, because there are various interconnected food chains. Okay, and since there are various interconnected food chains, every living organism is receiving the food, every living in the sense apart from the plant, because its source of energy is only sun. Okay, apart from this autotrophs, all other heterotrophs are receiving the food and the energy from various other food chains. Okay, so there are various food chains, and all this interconnected food chains is called the food web.
Organism experiences complex relationship with other organisms of its species and organisms of different species. In ecology, everything is connected to something else, and there is a constant interaction between organisms and their environments. Now, what is ecology? Ecology is the study of organisms in relation to their relative environments. It is either ethology or synecology. Okay, let's look at what an ecological concept is. Now, ecological concepts are general understandings. They are facts about ecosystem and ecosystem management. Now, this means that ecological concepts are the general facts about ecosystems. They are the information, the knowledge about ecosystem and how ecosystem can be managed by humans. Now, ecological principles are based assumptions or beliefs about ecosystems and how they function that are informed by the ecological concepts. That means ecological concepts bring about ecological principles. Okay, that takes us to the basic ecological concepts. Basic ecological concepts provide a framework for understanding and researching more about the ecosystem. Now, these concepts, what it means is that these concepts gives us the understanding, the insight of what the ecosystem is all about, and for further research. Now, we have concepts like the population ecology, which is also known as horticulture. The horticulture studies reveals the dynamics of species population and how these populations interact with the wider environment. A population consists of individual organisms or species that live, interact, and migrate through the same niche and habitat. Now we have the community ecology, also known as the synecology. It is the study of group of organisms of different species which are associated together as a unit. We have the biosphere, which is the part of the earth and atmosphere inhabited by living organisms. We have the ecological niche, which is the position that animals occupy in a habitat. It includes the physical space where the organism is found and its role in that habitat in terms of feeding relationship and other interactions with other species. Now, we have another concept called the habitat. Habitat is a specific locality with a particular set of conditions where organisms live. Habitats are categorized into terrestrial, which is the land, and the aquatic, which is the water habitats. Now we have the biomass. Biomass is the total dry weight of living organisms at a particular trophic level or per unit area. Example, when you talk about the total weight of maize crop per hectare. Now we have the ecosystem. The ecosystem is a natural unit composed of abiotic and biotic factors whose interactions lead to self-sustaining systems. Example of such is seen a small bond or a large ecosystem such as the tropical forest. Now we have another concept, which is carrying capacity. This means the maximum number of organisms an area can comfortably support without depletion of the available resources. Benefits of ecological concepts. We have the environmental conservation. Now, basic ecological concepts provide on how every organism needs others for peaceful coexistence. It provides knowledge of how every other organism needs each other for peaceful coexistence. Now, we have the benefit of resource allocation. Ecological concepts helps us to know the resources that are needed by different species, such as the air, mineral, space. A lack of the ecological study may be the cause of deprivation and looting of these natural resources. It's also of importance in terms of energy conservation. The entire living organisms needs energy such as nutrients, such as light, radiation, etc. So lack of these studies will cause the destruction of the energy sources. Oil, coal, natural gases are the non-renewable sources which destroy the ozone layer. Now we have another benefit. We have another benefit, which is the eco-friendliness. It helps to appreciate living among organisms. This will follow natural order of things. In summary, we've been able to say every living organism needs other organisms for coexistence. We've been able to learn that nature and environment are commonly used terms for ecology. Now, knowledge of ecological concepts helps to prevent degradation of land and environment, which is a living place of all species.